Station, Houston. Are you ready for the event?
Houston, this is Station. We are ready for the event.
Copy that. KARE-TV, this is Mission Control, Houston. Please call Station for a voice check.
Good stuff, and good morning. Thanks for joining us. Happy Friday. We want you to think about your morning routine right now. Maybe get up, you grab a cup of joe, you turn on sunrise before starting your day.
Now, picture how that would change if perhaps you were living up in space. Since Minnesota astronaut Mark Vandehei arrived on board the International Space Station some 2 months ago, life has been one wild ride. Consider the BSM and St. John's grad has already conducted not one, but two spacewalks.
He's part of a five-person expedition stationed at the ISS right now. And this morning, we have the pleasure of talking to him live from space. Good morning, Mark.
Good morning, Alicia. How are you today?
Great. First of all, we're so thrilled that you're talking to us right now from space. I'm kind of geeking out. Where are you right now currently, and what time of day is it there for you? Is there a sense of time in space?
Yeah, that's a great question where we are. I don't have a window nearby, but I got a crew member who's helped me out by looking it up right now. The time of day in space is Greenwich Mean Time, so it's about 10:30 in the morning.
Okay, so not too far off from us. Not bad.
You've done two spacewalks. Describe what that felt like to be outside of the space station. It's going to be a little nerve-wracking.
Quite honestly, yes, it was a little nerve-wracking, especially the first time. The second time, I was much more relaxed. One of my most striking emotions was the sunlight pouring into the airlock where we were waiting for to start the spacewalk. When the commander opened the hatch, it was clear that we were getting ready to go outside, kind of like on a wintry, sunny day in Minnesota with all the snow reflecting off of the whiteness.
I can't even imagine. We have been so excited to talk to you, and some of our viewers, we asked them what questions they wanted, and Bronwyn wants to know, is astronaut food as bad as they say it is?
Well, I would say we all have our favorites and dislikes. So I don't think it's bad. I think it's actually really, really good. Again, there's some things I don't enjoy very much, and there's some things I'm absolutely amazed with. For example, we have shrimp cocktail, a dehydrated version, but once you add the water, it's really, really good.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
Well, the kids in Mrs. Boyd's music class at Parker Elementary want to know what music you listen to up in space.
Before I answer that question, I wanted to let you know that we're over the southwest United States, and in about 15 minutes, we'll be passing over Minnesota. Now, for the type of music, it depends on the situation. Normally, the opportunity I have to listen to music is while I'm running on a treadmill or exercising on a exercise, kind of like a weightlifting machine that uses vacuums for resistance, vacuum suction for resistance. And I tend to listen to very energetic music because of that, because I'm trying to keep myself motivated to keep pushing myself hard.
And Mark, this is something that you prepared your whole life to do. You're about halfway through your mission, about 2 months in of a 5.5-month mission. What about this has maybe surprised you the most about this experience to this point?
A couple things I would say. Looking out the window and seeing the blackness of space as opposed to a sunlit Earth, and how thin the atmosphere looks relative to the size of the Earth. It's really striking how fragile and delicate life on Earth seems when you see it from the perspective of 250 miles up.
I have a question about the treadmill. You said you're running on a treadmill. How does that work in space?
Tim, great question. So the way we do that is we have kind of like, it's a harness, kind of like shoulder pads without the plastic. But we use that with bungee cords to hold us down, and the length of the bungee cords can determine how much force we have pulling ourselves down towards the treadmill. Otherwise, as soon as we took a step, we'd push ourselves away from it.
Mark, unfortunately, we have to wrap things up. But on behalf of the staff here at Care 11, and I think everybody back here in Minnesota, we just want to say safe travels, and we are so, so proud of you. And good luck with the rest of your mission.
Thank you very much. Great talking to you today.
Okay.
Station, this is Houston ACR. That concludes the Care TV portion of the event. Please stand by for a voice check from Fox and Friends.
Fox and Friends, this is Mission Control Houston. Please call station for a voice check.
Donation for media purposes from the Latino Victory Fund, the group behind the ad. To qualify as an in-kind donation, the candidate or campaign must request or suggest it. And parents of high schoolers in one community, they're outraged this morning over a controversial math problem.
Fox Station, this is Fox from Friends. How do you hear me?
Calculate the time it took for one of the planes to strike the World Trade
Center. Fox and Friends, we have you
officials
loud and clear.
From the Massachusetts school issued an apology saying they did not mean to disrespect those affected by the tragedy. And one of President Trump's favorite phrases.
Okay, we'll be with you in just a moment.
Listen to this.
Give you a
can
question.
You, can you stay categorical?
You are fake news.
I called the fake news the enemy of the people, and they are.
That was just fake news by NBC, which gives a lot of fake news.
I'll give you 2 seconds to guess the word or the phrase, fake news. You got it. Collins Dictionary says usage of fake news is up 365% since last year. They define it as false, often sensational information disseminated under the guise of news reporting. Other finalists include Echo Chamber, Antifa, and Fidget Spinner. Those are your headlines. You got it over there, guys. You got it on
my credit, Pete Hegg, that. All of those terms he uses every single weekend. All the time.
All right. Randy, can I have you raise your hand for Fox and Friends? Will you please raise your hand?
Here's Janice Dean.
Some people would like to call it fake if they don't like the winter.
If you get it right.
They don't like the winter time. Sometimes we don't get it right.
Great. Okay, thank you. Stand by, about 30 seconds away.
Is running in the New York City Marathon this weekend. Anybody in the room?
No.
Okay. We are looking at the potential for some showery weather for New York City on Sunday, but warmer temperatures. Let's take a look at it. Across the Northeast, that rainy weather is coming in on Sunday, but we've got a big winter storm across the Northwest. We're going to see a lot of snow in the highest of elevations. So we're getting the ski season up and running across the Northwest and the Sierra Nevada. This is the first big winter storm for them. So, you know, snow lovers are going to love this forecast. People who don't like the winter aren't going to like the forecast. But we do have winter weather advisories for millions of folks if you live across the West, the Northern Plains as well. And real quick, here is one of the model forecasts. Several feet of snow in the highest of elevations of the Rockies.
Okay, crew, do I just want to let you know our third host this morning is Rob O'Neill. He is the man who killed Osama bin Laden.
A little wet, but at least it'll be warm, right?
Yeah.
And one more reminder, daylight saving time. So we get one more. This is the good the good part of it, right?
That's
we get one
the best
more hour.
Night of the year for morning time.
Right? For Abby? Get
no
one
kidding.
More hour.
All right.
We'll take it.
Here we go. Stand by.
Yeah. Your homeland, Montana, is going to wind up with a foot in some spots.
That usually does, too. We've had snow in July in Montana.
Wow.
During the 4th of July parade, I'm pretty sure.
I'm pretty sure.
I think so.
That's not hashtag fake weather, is it?
Well, it was some parade, and we have a lot of Irish up there, so we have parades once in a while.
Yeah, but when it snows out there, it's so pretty.
It's nice. Big sky country. Once you get up there and see Montana, and just you don't know why it's the big sky state. It's a big sky.
Yeah.
All right. Speaking of the big sky, if in the night sky, you can see it.
Space, an out-of-this-world mission for the expedition crew.
That's right. They are in the International Space Station. You can actually see it from time to time with the naked eye. So let's bring them in. We've got NASA Commander Randy Bresnik and flight engineers Joe Acaba and Mark Vande High from the International Space Station. Just a word of caution for the folks at home. There is a six-second delay between the time we finish a question and the time they answer. So it's going to be a little awkward, but that's the price of talking to space. Commander, let's start with you. Tell us about the mission. What is the mission for your crew on the International Space Station right now?
We're up here aboard the International Space Station with partner agencies from Russia, from Japan, Canada, and the European Space Agency. We're up here doing science in the place that we cannot do on Earth. Microgravity, we're doing science experiments on fluids, on combustion. We're growing plants. We're executing stuff that is finding cures for diseases and finding vaccines. So we're doing a lot of stuff every day, and it's been continuously up here for the last 17 years.
goodness.
Mark, this is the first time you have been to space, to the International Space Station. Was it what you expected it would be like?
The mic.
Quite honestly, it's a little harder living in space than I expected. At first, it felt like someone's hanging me up by my feet, but now I'm having a lot of fun going around corners and just a sense of being able to do things and move in ways that we could never do on the ground.
So, Joe, I have a question. What is your message to the American people from space?
Well, I would tell the American people that the American space program is going on, and it's very, very strong. A lot of people don't know the work we're doing up here and all of the work that we continue to do as we look to get past low Earth orbit and go on to places further than we've ever been before. So let them know that, hey, we're strong, we are in space, and we're going to maintain our presence in space.
Well, that is terrific. Fellas, thank you very much for joining us today. And as we watch the microphone just float through and do a little tumbling right there, guys, since you are in a weightless environment, would you mind showing the folks at home what you can do?
Cool as that.
That's just awesome.
Yeah, folks at home, don't try that. These are professionals in space. That is awesome.
Is that a fidget spinner? That is amazing.
That's one of the words of the year.
It spins on its own.
Look at that.
Thank you guys so much. It was so wonderful having you on this morning. What a cool segment.
Yeah, that's great.
And good luck out there.
All right, indeed.
Unbelievable. Thank you.
Pleasure joining you. Take care.
Station, this is Houston ACR. That concludes the event.
Thank you, all participants from KARE-TV and Fox and Friends Station. We are now resuming operational audio communications.
Mm-hmm.